Welcome to my home. I'm Dr. Nick Begich, and today's video that we're producing is HAARP and beyond. It's been a long time since we produced a video on HAARP and really brought out the information in the context of where we are now in 2006 versus where we were when we first disclosed this story in the book Angels Don't Play This HAARP back in 1995. So today's topic will deal with the various aspects of HAARP and talk about what's happened since with some of the key players involved in that research, as well as the political implications and where this technology is going from here. First time that you've seen a video or gotten familiar with any of our work, so I want to give you a little bit of background on me. I'm Dr. Nick Begich. I have a doctorate in traditional and complementary medicines. I come from a political family here in Alaska, second generation of political involvement here. I also have a background in education, being twice elected president of the Alaska Federation of Teachers and the Anchorage Council of Education. I've written three books, co-authored with James Roderick and Gene Manning. And I'm presently the executive director of the Lay Foundation on Technologies, which is involved in researching and educating the public on technology issues. And currently, it's providing us a great deal of the research base necessary to produce this video and much of our work into the future. Welcome to my library. I want to start with a little discussion of the Lay Institute on Technology, Inc., which was set up as a Texas nonprofit corporation primarily to educate the public on the impacts of technology. And as a result of that effort and my work with Dorothy Lay, the founder of that foundation, we're able to continue to archive and develop material that's useful for research projects like this and many others. In fact, all that material now is posted on the internet at www.layinstitute.org. And if you go there and you look at the site, there's an area called EPI search, and that is our research index. And so if you go there, you can search any keyword. You can look up HAARP or climate change or radio or microwave or any of the words that are of interest to you, and you'll see every document that we've stored there on those archives available to the public in a way that makes it more useful in researching these issues. So take a look at that. It's useful in conjunction with this production today. But let's get back to the HAARP issue and where that issue began for me. HAARP started really with a very short segment, a little article actually in a magazine called Nexus, an Australian journal. I read the article and it was about a project taking place here in Alaska called HAARP, the High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project. And at that time, it was being operated by the U.S. Navy and Air Force in developing what they called a developmental prototype for weapons applications of a very, very large radio frequency array or field of antennas located here in Alaska. And so, you know, what happened when I read that article is I looked at it and I thought, you know, Alaska is a big place geographically, but when you think about it politically, it's very small. We have a small population. You tend to hear about what's going on, and virtually nothing had been reported in our local media regarding this project. And I'm kind of a curious person, and the article was pretty outrageous in what it was claiming. So I went and looked at what was available first by searching the sources that were cited in that article at our local library, LUSAC, which happens to be one of 78 libraries at that time in the country that were designated as federal repositories, places where any unclassified federal record are either stored or they have to produce it for you for free. So it's an incredible research library here in Anchorage, and as I said, 78 of them around the United States. As a result, we were able to verify all of the sources in that article. That got me pretty concerned, and I went next to talk to Trustees for Alaska, which is one of the larger sort of umbrella environmental groups in Alaska, and my thought was, you know, with the implications of this system, this group certainly had to be following the issue, and surprisingly, they weren't. In fact, they said the Audubon Society was looking at it. So I went over to the Audubon Society in Anchorage and talked to them. They had a very short file on the HAARP project, and basically what they were concerned about was the few hundred of acres of wetlands that were going to be disturbed and they were concerned about the flyway, where birds, migratory birds, were coming across that particular region. But those were their only concerns. There were much, much bigger implications to HAARP. Discovering that virtually nobody was following the issue, it seemed like a very, very important issue to me. And so what I did is I sent a large amount of material, including the technical specifications for the array, to a friend of mine, a physicist, who had the background to take a look at whether or not the claims on this facility were actually real and whether it really was a threat. The conclusion that he and others made was that it was a very significant issue, one that needed some public attention, and they insisted that I write an article about the subject. And so that began, for me, a journey that's now lasted 11 years in dealing with this issue and those things that came out of it. But let's talk about what HAARP can do. As I said, it's an array, a field of antennas. And what it essentially started as was 48, a 6 in one direction, 8 in another direction. And these are 72 feet tall with a cross dipole. So there are a column going up and then a cross dipole going like so. And by firing these antennae in a very specific order, you can focus the radio frequency energy, concentrate it to a relatively small area, up in an area above the Earth's surface called the ionosphere. And let me explain sort of where the ionosphere is. You've got to look about 30 miles above the Earth's surface for the very beginnings of the ionosphere, and then it stretches out perhaps as far as 400 kilometers out into space and even further in the upper reaches of the ionosphere. And it acts as an electrical shield, if you will, an energized area of our environment, so that cosmic radiations coming in from the sun and from space hit this layer, and it acts as a filter, filtering out particle streams that would make a life on planet Earth impossible without this. Now, people talk about ozone depletion as a major issue, and it certainly is, and we'll cover that in another video in this series. But let's talk about a hole in the ionosphere, which would be significantly greater than any problem attributed to ozone depletion by comparison, because of the kinds of radiation. It wouldn't be just ultraviolet radiation, as is the case with ozone. This would be very, very dangerous particle streams that would literally alter the genetic blueprint of the planet. So this is the area that the military is targeting as their research area in the developments of HAARP. And HAARP was originally invented by a guy named Dr. Bernard Eastland, and it was an original concept that he had, and he had gone had this idea that you could create a shielding effect. And let me talk a little bit about what kind of effect that might be. When you look at the ionosphere as this layer around the Earth, and then if you think of the Earth as also kind of a giant motor that's spinning around, and with that comes magnetic field lines. And these field lines go from the southern part of the poles all the way up, and they wrap around, they come back in at the northern polar regions. And in these polar regions, where those magnetic field lines interact with the atmosphere and oxygen and nitrogen, you get the aurora borealis, or the northern lights. Or in the southern hemisphere, you get the equivalent of our northern lights. And it's where this energy is interacting with the atmosphere. Well, by using these naturally occurring field lines, you can actually manipulate energy coming off the ground, coming off of a field of antennas like what HAARP has in Gokana, Alaska, which is just 250 miles northeast of Anchorage. This facility that was built in the early 1990s has been advanced significantly. It started with 48 antennae. They now have 180 in the array, eventually 360. The idea is, again, to focus that energy. By firing this in a sequence, this array, you can create what's called cyclotron resonance, which would be visually seen as sort of a corkscrewing motion of the energy as it rolls up into the ionosphere, getting more and more concentrated as it goes. Just the opposite of the way radio frequency energy generally works when it comes off of a broadcast antenna where we hear radio programs today. What happens in that case is the energy starts out concentrated, spreads out very, very rapidly, in the same way that light from a flashlight spreads out very rapidly. They follow the same basic principles in physics. But as with light, it can be concentrated in the form of a laser, where that light is concentrated and very, very powerful at far distances, The same is true by analogy with radio frequency energy and the HAARP array. That's what makes it so much different than anything else on the planet. The upper limits of the array in terms of effective radiated power, which is not the input power, but it's the effective radiated power, how that energy actually relates in the environment. In this case, the desired level is 1 billion watts of effective radiated power, a huge amount of energy. And being able to manipulate that energy in a variety of ways for weapons applications. Now, why would they locate a facility like this in Alaska? You remember when I was talking about those magnetic field lines surrounding the Earth? The idea was that if you could send cyclotron resonance, this energy coming off of the radio frequency array, this radio frequency energy in this form up to those magnetic lines of force, they'd corkscrew themselves around them. And instead of the energy flowing north to south, the energy would be using that as a waveguide to go from north to south, the opposite direction. So in this case, what then happens is, as you energize these field lines around the planet, any object passing through them would encounter a huge amount of energy that would disrupt the avionics, the electronics that control the flight path of intercontinental ballistic missiles or anything else in the region, including satellites, low orbiting satellites and the like. So the idea was to create this shield. That was number one. The amount of energy that was required was huge. So Dr. Eastland went to ARCO. At that time, Atlantic Richfield had huge, huge natural gas resources on the North Slope of Alaska, ideally suited, according to Eastland's patents, for exploitation for this technology, because natural gas supplies would allow the conversion to electrical energy using magnetohydrodynamic generators, called out in Eastland's patents. And then from there, that electrical energy could be fed into this huge array and then sent up to the ionosphere for the various weapons applications. So the ideal situation presented itself in the early 90s, and it was location within the boundaries of the United States for a ground-based system that, in effect, as we go through the day today, you'll see, has all of the ramifications that were being sought in the 80s under the old Star Wars concepts. The idea of a global missile shield or protection from adversaries using low-orbiting space platforms and the like. So here we had a technology emerging that could solve those things. For Atlantic Richfield, it was great because there's no gas line presently coming out of Alaska to bring that gas to market. And we've been producing oil from that field for over 30 years, yet we can't get the natural gas. So for ARCO to be able to sell the gas to the military right where it is, offered tremendous advantage. So they set up ARCO Power Technologies, Inc., a subsidiary with 30 employees. They originally bid on the HAARP project after selling the concept to the military in the early days in the late 80s. Dr. Eastland actually put together that original team that became ARCO Power Technologies, Inc. Now what they did as a subsidiary, they had no track record of military contracting. They had really no history at all. They bid for the HAARP construction and applications on that project and won. And who did they bid against? Raytheon Corporation, for one. Raytheon at the time was one of the was the 44th largest company in the world, according to Forbes magazine. And they were the inventors of things like the Patriot missiles and some of the new active denial systems being promoted today. In other words, they had real weapons applications and histories. Yet this little subsidy, ARCO Power Technologies, won the contract. Now, in public procurement, the way you win those contracts is actually through what's called proprietary information. Certain companies are given extra points and advantage if they hold the technical knowledge necessary to carry a project out. In this case, ARCO Power Technologies, Inc. owned those nine critical patents associated with the HAARP program. And those are cited in the book Angels Don't Play This HAARP, along with over 300 military, academic, and mainstream media reports on HAARP. So that's the place if you really want that detailed source material. Get the book, take a look at the bibliographical indexes, also look at the Lay Institute site. The fact is, what happened in all of this development was this excitement from ARCO, because here it was. They were going to make money on gas they could never make money on before. But what happened is, The company went through some controversies, some changes. Company eventually sold. Actually, ARCO is no longer here. But the company itself, the subsidiary, was later sold to another organization called E-Systems. And E-Systems was the subject of Washington Post reports back in the early 90s. They predominantly were, at that time, were a $2.1 billion company with the vast majority of their income derived from what are called black projects, projects so secret even the U.S. Congress doesn't know what they're funding. And the citations regarding that are also in the book, Angels Don't Play This Harp. The point is, this company ends up with the patents and the subsidiary. And what did they do? They sold out. They sold to none other than Raytheon Corporation, the losing bidder on the first project in the beginning. So Raytheon ends up with the intellectual property. They end up with that project, and they later sold to British Aerospace, which is an interesting change of events, and that was in 2003. The project also shifted in 2003 from the Navy and the Air Force over to DARPA, which is the Defense Department's research agency that deals with, again, very, very classified research and projects. But let's go back to what does HAARP really do? Okay, so we've talked about how it focuses energy, but what would you do with that energy when you focus it? There were a number of concepts that Dr. Eastland had. First of all was the issue of communications. The ionosphere, this layer above the Earth, when you think about, if you ever think about shortwave, how it broadcasts around the Earth, it literally strikes the ionosphere and bounces. And that's what allows shortwave to get around the curvature of the Earth and around the horizon. It uses the ionosphere. But when the ionosphere is disturbed, say, by really active solar activity, communications are also disturbed. Satellite communications can be disturbed. We know that when the ionosphere is active because the sun is active, that communication systems, even power grids across the planet, can be affected by the way energy is exchanged between the sun and the Earth and the systems within the Earth. So knowing about the ionosphere and controlling it becomes extremely important for communications purposes, and we can all see why the military would be interested in that. What they found is that they could disturb the ionosphere to such an extent using these kinds of systems that they could deny everyone else access to their communication systems. But by controlling those modulations and by controlling those pulse frequencies affecting the ionosphere, they could carry their own communications while denying everyone else access to theirs. Now again, if you can communicate with all of your aspects of your military and you can deny your adversary the ability to do that, we can certainly see the advantages of exploring that whole area. And that doesn't in itself present problems. What presents the problems is when we start manipulating this very important aspect of our environment without really knowing what the long-term consequences of those manipulations might be. Now let's talk a little bit about some of the other applications, because this is sort of a very versatile instrument in terms of how it can be used. And it essentially covers, according to one study that was done by the University of Maryland, it was an executive report for the Congress, and what they did is they looked at sort of what parts of the spectrum could you affect. And everything from ultra-low frequencies to visible light can be affected, which covers 16 decades of frequency, which is a huge, huge range. For those that are technically oriented. Now, HAARP actually operates with its primary frequencies in a little narrow band in the middle of that range. But by manipulating that energy, they can affect this entire range of spectrum. And that's one of the key elements of HAARP. It's not just what it can do in its primary mode of operation, but by pulsing and then modulating a signal on that carrier, you can create much, much different effects. One of the other effects that Dr. Eastland pointed out in his patent was the idea of being used for over-the-horizon radar. Now, this is really interesting because the old technology for the over-the-horizon radar, as things got in close, things would become very distorted, so you couldn't see them. And you could really only see things at pretty high elevations. You couldn't see things, for instance, like cruise missiles coming in at those very low ground elevations. With the ability of HAARP and over-the-horizon technology that it offers, you get everything from intercontinental ballistic missiles, those things coming in from, literally coming back in from space, re-entering the atmosphere, all the way down to cruise missile heights, things coming out at a few hundred feet above the Earth's surface and following its contours. And you don't get distortion when it gets close in. Again, we can see the advantages of doing that. For that application, you actually need two transmitters, and Alaska does have two. High Pass, located just outside of Fairbanks near the Poker Flats rocket range, which is a small array, and then the larger array at Gokana, Alaska, which is, again, 250 miles northeast of Anchorage. Now there, what you can do then is you can literally energize an area of the ionosphere, and it creates what's called a cold plasma or layer of energy that acts like a reflective mirror. And by moving it around and steering it, you can then send a signal from the other transmitter and bounce it over the curvature of the Earth. So you get this over-the-horizon effect. If you use, again, one of the other patents in this cluster held by ARCO Power Technologies, Inc., is a gamma-ray detector designed for satellite-based applications, and utilizing first the HAARP system to create a unique energy pattern around each of the incoming objects, then using gamma ray detectors based on satellites, they could actually determine which of those incoming objects carry nuclear payloads and which ones are simply decoys. Extremely important, because in all nuclear scenarios, except for those by rogue states, we envision 100,000 incoming objects, of which only perhaps a few hundred actually carry nuclear payloads. Now, we don't have the capability of knocking out all of those objects, but if we could isolate the real threats, those that carry nuclear payloads, then obviously an advantage is gained there. So that over the horizon application, and then the idea of detecting by the unique energy signature around all those objects. And then the third application in this series was the idea of creating what's called an EMP, an electromagnetic pulse, or a surge of energy so strong that it overrides the electronic circuits, those little microcircuits within all of sophisticated electronics and computer systems, overrides them, causing bit errors and computer error that causes those aircrafts to crash. And in some cases, with enough EMP power, you can literally melt circuitry. So three phases. If you increase the power sufficiently on the HAARP facility, you can create this EMP effect and knock out everything in the sky. Now, obviously, in a nuclear scenario, we can see the need for something like this, but at the same time, everything else that's in that space or in that range is also going to be knocked out. All the civilian aircraft, that's the collateral damage in such an event, and if we were to use such technology. Now, Alaska is the place where the new system for missile defense is actually being constructed. Let's get back to the issue of missile defense for just a moment, because this is an extremely important aspect of the whole HAARP story, because this is really where it began. You know, when you go back to 95, when we were first publishing on the subject, you know, Gene Manning and I wrote the book Angels Don't Play This HAARP, really as a beginning point to get public debate on the issue. I've done thousands of radio broadcasts in the last 11 years on this issue, as well as traveled to Europe 13 times on related issues. Now, at one point, early on in 1997, I got a call from a gentleman, Tom Spencer, and Tom was at that time the environmental chairman of the European Parliament, and he was a conservative from Great Britain. And Tom asked me a lot about HAARP, wanted the information. Apparently someone here in the United States who had heard us on radio, gotten a copy of our book, had forwarded it on to him, and it got his attention. Now, when he made inquiries into the British military about HAARP and related technologies, the answer he kept getting from them was, Tom, stay out of this. Don't get involved. And for Tom Spencer, that was really the wrong answer. In fact, it was his ticket to the dance, because it got him very involved in this issue. We began a dialogue, and he brought myself and a friend of mine, a physicist, over to actually Brussels, where we were able to meet with him and other parliamentarians and others involved in military-related issues. And we also were able to form an association between the Greens, the Social Democrats, and the Conservatives around the HAARP issue, largely because of the work of Tom Spencer. Now, in the interim, several things started to happen. Tom brought us into a couple of different venues, and I want to tell the story, because it's a big part of sort of how this thing started to shape. He brought us in to a number of venues, and the first one was one on Arctic issues by the organization called GLOBE, and this was an organization composed of 200 federally elected or nationally elected legislators from 44 governments from around the world, dealing primarily with environmental-related issues. And this was an opportunity to talk about HAARP within that forum. Right after our presentation, we were approached by members of the Russian Duma. Now, this is going back to 1997-98 time frame. They approached us, were very interested in the issue, because Russians, actually, the Soviets back in the 70s, had utilized very similar systems. In fact, if you go back, there was a signal that was reported by shortwave broadcasters as the woodpecker signal, and it was this irritating noise that they would pick up on shortwave broadcasts. They triangulated the positions back to five transmitters in the former Soviet Union that were responsible for creating those signals. Those were the early predecessors to HAARP, and we'll get back to that in a little bit. But in the European Parliament, Tom Spencer then became chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, the most powerful committee, or one of the most powerful in the European Parliament. He then was able to bring us back to testify in the Security and Disarmament Subcommittee of the Foreign Affairs Committee on the issue of HAARP. And what eventually happened is several sections were included in a European Parliament resolution on disarmament, specifically addressing the problems associated with HAARP. And what we were able to demonstrate there are many of the applications and uses by presenting non-classified military documents as well as the planning documents from the facility, and in tracing and showing the history of this facility. The Europeans acted, as did later the Russians in 2002 when they passed their own similar resolution. The problem, going back to that testimony in the European Parliament in February of 98, was one issue that we raised where they had strong objections. And we had said in that hearing that the United States would unilaterally abandon the ABM treaty, the anti-ballistics missile treaty with the former Soviet Union, considered one of the anchors in world peace globally by Europeans and our traditional allies as well as our adversaries. The idea that we would abrogate that without cluing in our traditional allies in Brussels and throughout Western Europe, they just couldn't accept. The fact is, we had said it would happen within a year. We were off by 3 months. It was 3 months later that the United States began their moves, which eventually led to the abandonment of that treaty. This was done under both the Clinton administrations and the Bush administrations. Even though Clinton had said he would never support this kind of move, he in the end, in fact, did. What happened then is a lot of concerns, because we were so right on in terms of our predictions of what was going to happen. We even gave them the rationale that the senior senator from Alaska, Ted Stevens, would use, which was, there is no Soviet Union, therefore there is no treaty. That's what he said on the floor of the United States Senate in the prelude to the abandonment of that treaty. This is a problem, and it has been a problem for our European allies, and probably was one of the most significant points of disembarking from a policy of cooperation, because when you think about it, they really should have been clued in. Parliamentarians should have been part of a dialogue that involves something so strategically important to them, our traditional allies, our NATO allies, the abandonment of a fundamental treaty. The other issue, going back to HAARP, that was raised in the hearings was this whole issue of how else would it be used? What are the implications environmentally, et cetera? And, you know, we were supposed to have a 15-minute presentation. They actually gave me an hour and a half to present on these issues because of the ramifications of HAARP. They later issued a report that didn't just include the ramifications of HAARP, but all of these systems associated with it and this whole direction in technology that's taking place today, of which HAARP is just a small part. But let's get back to some of the other applications of HAARP and some of the other things that it can do. One of the other applications that came up early on was the idea of what's called earth-penetrating tomography. Let me make that really simple. By analogy, it would be like X-raying the Earth or looking into the Earth several kilometers or several miles deep to look at underground structures for mineral deposits, nuclear facilities, tunnels, mining facilities, all those kinds of things can be detected by earth-penetrating tomography. Now, the way that this would work with HAARP is really unique, and this is again going back to Dr. Eastland's patents. By sending this energy up, this focused energy up to the ionosphere, what they can do is they can pulse the energy so it acts like a punch. So it's punching the ionosphere with this force that causes the ionosphere to vibrate in resonance, in harmony with this signal on the ground. So, for instance, in Norway, where they have one of these facilities operating, They were able to play Wagner in a way that got the ionosphere to literally vibrate to Wagner, as an example. In the low frequency range, extremely low frequency range, the ELF range, it sends a signal back to the Earth. And ELF signals are very long wavelengths. And what they do is they penetrate the Earth and sea, all the way through the Earth and sea. Nothing stops these ELF signals from penetrating. Unlike the shorter wavelengths, the millimeter and centimeter wavelengths of other communication systems, microwave systems, and so on, these don't penetrate very deep. So they can't get down to, say, submarines at depth. So the way we communicate with submarines around the planet is we use 14 to 26 mile long antennas buried under the ground that create these ELF signals. They're in Michigan and Wisconsin and some out on the Aleutian chain and other locations around the world. What HAARP offered was a new technology that would literally change the ionosphere by sending that energy up and pulsing it in. The ionosphere then acts as a broadcast antenna sending back energy to the Earth. In the ELF range at fairly low energy concentrations, approximately the same as what the Earth naturally produces. These signals penetrate the Earth, and their character is measured by instruments on the ground or low-flying objects that can then pick up these signals and then determine exactly what those underground structures look like. In MSNBC, right after 9/11, November 27th, 2001, there was an MSNBC report where they cited HAARP as a useful technology to use in Afghanistan for locating all of those underground facilities and the like. And the reason that they knew it would work in those applications is going back to 1995 in the congressional appropriations under the defense budget in that year, they appropriated $11 million to HAARP to test just that application under the caveat that if it didn't work for Earth-penetrating tomography, or they didn't test that application, it wouldn't get any more funding. Now, they tested the application and on a program on the ionosphere on a show called Horizons, aired on BBC TV. A professor from the University of Maryland, Professor Papadopoulos, actually talked about the results of the Earth-penetrating tomography test with HAARP, where they were looking at underground mining facilities in the area surrounding Fairbanks, Alaska, and were able to determine with 99% accuracy the location of those tunnels when comparing them to the actual maps and surveys of those underground workings. So they proved the technology would work. If you go back to Atlantic Richfield, the oil company that started this whole project, you can see why they would be interested. I mean, if you get a whole profile of the entire North Slope regions of Alaska and other oil-producing regions of the world and know with certainty what's under the ground, great things for their perspective and their shareholders could be gained. In fact, an expert in this area was able to look at that idea, this earth-penetrating tomography issue, a guy named Brooks Agnew. Brooks Agnew is an interesting guy. He is a specialist in earth-penetrating tomography, and actually there's an article by him posted on my website at earthpulse.com. At that site, you can read the article in detail, but basically what he found is back during the 80s and 90s, he was doing work in earth-penetrating tomography for the oil industry. And what he was able to do is with 30 watts of power, which is, you know, nothing compared to a billion watts of effective radio power with HAARP, but with 30 watts of power, he was able to get profiles of ground strata several kilometers deep. And he actually used this with a company that's now fairly well known, Halliburton. He went around to 9 states and 26 known drill sites where they actually knew exactly what the ground strata was and the oil and gas grades that were there. And Brooks Agnew, with his technology, earth-penetrating tomography, was able to determine with 99% accuracy not only the ground strata differentials, but whether there was oil and gas in the ground and whether and the quality of those oil and gas deposits. That is incredible technology, considering that the method of use was not disturbing in terms of natural systems at those very low power levels. Yet, you know, when you think about oil and gas, you know, those are public resources. Having certainty about where to drill and what to do would certainly change the dynamics of how the industry competitively fought for those resources and would have huge implications in the economies of the world. But the point of the matter is that technology is not being used for mineral exploration today. It's being used primarily for military applications, as is the case with HAARP. The question in my mind has always been, did any of these guys under any of these transfer agreements, did the oil companies retain rights? Did they keep rights so they could utilize that data in the future? Why isn't the U.S. government utilizing that data for isolating oil fields within the United States and other places? It's a good question and one that still remains to be answered. But when you get into earth-penetrating tomography, the problem that Brooks Agnew has and others have voiced is the idea of the energy concentrations, because what he knew is that if you used too much energy, in his worst-case scenario, you could trigger geologic events, earthquakes, those kinds of events could be triggered utilizing high energy densities in the ELF range. In fact, there was a DOD news briefing. It goes back to April 27th, 1997, and it was at the University of Georgia, and it was Secretary of Defense William Cohen. He was commenting on weapons of mass destruction. Remember, that's way before 9/11. And one of the weapons of mass destruction he cited were environmental weapon systems utilizing electromagnetic energy for triggering earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, and climate alterations. This is the U.S. Secretary of Defense, William Cohen, making that statement in a DOD news briefing in 1997. The idea of using energy or accidentally triggering these events was the big concern of Brooks Agnew when he started looking at HAARP as an issue. The other was, what would happen if this energy going up into the ionosphere actually acted as a conductor or formed a shunt connecting to the Earth this energy from the ionosphere? What he envisioned would then happen is it would form a tap where the energy actually flowed from the ionosphere down to the Earth, and it would look like, according to Brooks Agnew, the biggest bolt of lightning you've ever seen in your life striking the Earth 40 times a second. Now, granted, the idea of bolt of lightning, the biggest you've ever seen, striking the Earth 40 times a second until all that energy was discharged out of the ionosphere is, granted, the most extreme of situations and one that certainly hasn't manifested itself yet. But these are the kinds of concerns being raised by independent scientists literally around the world and now by some of the governments around the world. There's a couple of other applications of HAARP that I want to talk a little bit about. The first one, and these are the two most, probably the most controversial areas of HAARP, the first one deals with the idea of manipulating weather systems. And this is a very important issue because, again, you're dealing with concepts that have been attempted over the years. In fact, these days you've actually got the United States Congress, two bills pending, one in the Senate, one in the House, to create a commission for review of weather modification technology, because commercial interests are now advancing them along with other militaries from around the world. So you've got economic interest interested as much as the military in controlling weather outcomes and climate outcomes for obvious advantage and reasons. But it creates problems, and here's what happens with HAARP. HAARP is also capable of, in fact, the early versions were called ionospheric heaters because they literally would heat the ionosphere. And when you think of this area being heated, it's about 30 miles in diameter above the facility itself. And when you heat the area up by affecting this region, you literally push it up. So it goes up and out into space, perhaps as far as 200 kilometers. Instead of being 30 miles above the Earth's surface, now you're almost a couple hundred miles potentially out into space with this column, and the lower atmosphere below rushes in to fill that space. Now, what happens then? Firstly, any satellite that was a low orbiting satellite zipping through space hits this area, hits this energized area that's supposed to be there, and all of a sudden it hits atmosphere, it encounters friction, and the satellite burns up and it crashes. So as anti-satellite technology. The Russians, through the Strategic Studies Institute in London, reported that they had actually looked at Russian papers that had a concept for incoming comets and asteroids. You know, most of these things, when they come into our atmosphere, they burn up because you've got this 30 miles where these objects are coming in at such high velocities, they encounter the friction, they begin to burn up and they break up and nothing ever hits the Earth. But big objects make it to ground and big problems can occur accordingly. But think about, instead of 30 miles, having maybe 210 miles of range and distance of atmosphere to break up those incoming objects. Much larger objects could be destroyed in that way. That was some of the research that the Russians had done utilizing the technology of their heaters back in the 70s. Now, that all is interesting in and of itself, anti-satellite technology, the idea of what else happens when you burn that hole in the ionosphere is all of those particle streams, again, come in to fill that space. You know, very, very important situation. Now, granted, it's continually energized by the sun and by the activities of the planet in terms of our geomagnetics, but how long they leave it open, what occurs, those are things that are not being looked at by the biological scientists that ought to be affiliated with this program. So we really understand the implications of what's happening. If you take it a little bit further and you start to look at this whole concept of using a system on the ground to aggravate the ionosphere. Now, what else happens when that lower atmosphere rushes in? You also change pressure systems in the immediate region in terms of lows and highs and the way those pressure systems work and the way in which jet streams flow by altering the flow of jet streams, by altering the way the atmosphere is located within an area. That's where you can get these huge, huge problems. Back in the 1977, the United States ratified a treaty where we agreed to not use environmental manipulation as a weapon of war, whether it be to create earthquakes or tidal waves or volcanic eruptions or disturb the weather. All of these things were restricted under that treaty when they involved national boundaries or crossing national boundaries. Like most U.S. treaties, the exemption is for domestic use. The treaties we sign with all these other countries have a clause within them that allows use of the technologies that might be forbidden against another country to be used within the boundaries of your own country. The Chemical and Biological Treaty is a good one as an example. Russia being a signatory to that treaty, yet they used gases within the conflict with Chechnya when they had a bunch of people being trapped in a movie theater. You may remember this. They pumped in a gas that was supposed to knock everyone out so they could go in and take care of the terrorists and free the hostages. And in fact, over 100 people died from the asphyxiation. That particular gas would have been forbidden in an international conflict across the outside of the sovereignty of Russia. But again, these treaties do not have parallel legislation that goes up alongside of them that says, hey, if this is good enough for our adversaries, it's good enough for us. And really, we need that parallel legislation. Every time we sign a treaty, there ought to be a domestic law going right up alongside it. The environmental modification treaties were no exception. We continued our experimentation within the United States. The idea now that we can modify weather to large degree is something that's not just unique to the United States. The Russians, through private companies, have offered, according to New York Times articles, have offered that service to other governments to help with weather-related problems and issues. The idea also, the last three Secretaries of Defense, including the present one, have all called for the abandonment of that environmental treaty, primarily because the technologies have advanced to the point where controlling the environment for warfare applications becomes incredibly useful. Also for waging covert warfare, the idea of denying a country its rainfall for its agricultural production at the same time you have an embargo ongoing would be the kind of act of war that you could plausibly deny and yet have a devastating effect, even a greater effect than the traditional bombs and bullets. And this really gets into the essence of what's behind HAARP and technologies like HAARP. It's what the military now calls the revolution of military affairs, or they refer to it as a revolution of military and political affairs because of the way these things interrelate. What makes governments powerful today in the world is, in fact, their command of technology. If you look around the world, those governments with the highest technology are those that dominate the world scene. So technology becomes important for all of us to at least have conceptual knowledge of some of these projects, including HAARP. But HAARP is just one of many, many projects. And as we took this issue on, there was an underlying problem as well. Some of the things that were developed by the inventor, ideas that should be explored, were being ignored because military had no interest. A good example was Dr. Eastland had this idea that using radio frequency energy, you could actually trigger chemical reactions in the upper atmosphere, which in fact you can. I mean, it's well known. But what you can do by triggering these reactions is you could actually create ozone. In other words, if ozone depletion is truly a problem, here you have a system that can replenish ozone utilizing known laws of science. Likewise, knocking out particular pollutants, again, by understanding their interactions with radio frequency energy to be able to neutralize pollutants in the environment. None of these things are being looked at, and yet they offer huge potentials. I've had lots of conversations with Dr. Eastland over the years, and, you know, he's got a much different view. I mean, he's a senior scientist, an outstanding physicist on the world scene. His concepts today for advancing energy systems and ways to really free people and utilize his science not for our destruction but for its enhancement. And I think that's where lots of science gets misused, when those using it are only seeing certain applications. But let's get down to the most controversial issue dealing with HAARP, which is the physical effects on human health. And I want to get into the ELF effects, because this is extremely important. And there's another video in this series on mind control, which gets into this idea of being able to be overridden by radio frequency energy from the outside. And this is what we know from the research. If you go back to the mid-1980s, there was a document called Low Intensity Conflict in Modern Technology. It was produced at Maxwell Air Force Base, and it has a section in it on electromagnetic weapon systems, where it gets into a whole discussion of what was possible. If you even go back further, you got to go back to a book called Unless Peace Comes, published in 1969. Within that is a chapter called How to Wreck Your Environment. And the reason it's an important chapter, that's before Earth Day, you know, that was later in the 70s, so you could get away with a chapter like that. But nonetheless, the guy that wrote it was a guy named G.F. Gordon MacDonald, and he was a full professor at UCLA and a science advisor to President Johnson when he was in the presidency. And he had written back then that if we could ever figure out how to electronically stroke the ionosphere in just the right way, we could return a signal to the Earth that would literally manipulate the behavior of people over huge geographic areas. That was G.F. Gordon MacDonald's ideas going back then. But in 1969, we didn't have a way to electronically stroke the ionosphere and create that kind of returning signal. Later, in a book by Zbigniew Brzezinski, it was a book called Between Two Ages, and in this book is a reiteration of G.F. Gordon's ideas about, being able to electronically stroke the ionosphere and return a signal to the Earth. In this particular book by Brzezinski, and Brzezinski, for those who don't remember, he later became National Security Advisor to President Carter. At the time he wrote the book, he was a professor and researcher at Columbia University. But here's this idea. Now, how do you electronically stroke the ionosphere? That's exactly what HAARP does. But what kind of signal returns is what's relevant, and here's why. When you think about energy, most energy passes through us, and we have huge amounts of radio frequency energy passing through us right today. You know that nature creates a certain amount of radio frequency energy that has always been here, but man creates 200 million times more radio frequency energy than what nature creates. So that surrounds us. We're literally surrounding that soup, and that's just radio frequency energy. When you think of that whole electromagnetic spectrum, there's a whole lot of other energy that man's created that surrounds us as well. But the human body is really unique. It's like the ultimate tuner. Most energy passes through us like static between the stations. You know, when you're going through the radio stations and you're looking for that favorite channel, it's when resonance occurs between the receiver and the transmitter. That thing sending the energy, the radio station, to the radio receiver, when they're in harmony, you get a nice clear signal and you get your station. The same is true by analogy within the human body. And this is what the military research has shown, is that you can affect everything down to a molecular level if you understand enough about the physics of the body and the math of radio frequency energy's relationship to it. You can manipulate radio frequency energy to affect the body. And this is what they did actually in a study sponsored by the Air Force. The study was at the University of Utah. It was completed in 1985, and it was under the auspices of the Science Advisory Board to the Air Force, and it produced what's called the Radio Frequency Dosimetry Handbook. Simple language, it's the dosages of radio frequency energy necessary to override every vital organ of the body, including the brain, whether it be the liver, the kidneys, the heart, the lungs, to interfere with their natural performance. as a weapon or weapon application. Now again, you're talking about energy that is different. We're talking about a whole different view of warfare. We're using energy as the base. These technologies are now being developed for things like the active denial system, which is using knowledge of microwave, millimeter waves to affect the body to create pain or heat sensations, affecting only the nerve endings on the surface of the body. But these basic principles apply to the entire living organism. So Jose Delgado is an interesting guy. He was at Yale University in the mid-60s. He began mapping the human brain by planting electrodes in primates and humans to see how to affect the different parts of the brain, figure out what parts of the brain were affected and affected our health and the way we thought and just sort of how the brain worked, mapping it out. Well, by the mid-80s, you know, he had figured out a lot of other things. He found out that not only could you map the brain, but you could stimulate the brain. And so starting in 1969, he'd put the implants in, and there's a famous image of him with the charging bull, and he throws the switch of a transmitter, and the bull stops right in its tracks, right in front of the guy. And in this case, he used an implant that affected the bull in a way that caused it to stop. Now, what he found by the mid-80s is he didn't need any implanted technology whatsoever. All he needed was radio frequency energy modulated and pulsed in just the right way to carry a signal. And what they found is it took only 1/50th of what the Earth's natural radio frequency energy level was to affect us dramatically. And with the case of primates and humans, making them lethargic or passive, almost asleep, to highly agitated and awake, back and forth, like throwing a light switch on and off, on and off. No implants, no physical contact, using radio frequency energy, 1/50th of what the Earth naturally produces. HAARP, in its Earth penetrating tomography mode, will produce 50 times more energy than is necessary to override normal brain function, according to the research at Yale University and the research conducted by the Air Force and Navy in all of those projects that we cite within our published work. Now, when you think about the idea of manipulating brain activity, you can do it for all kinds of different reasons. I mean, it can be an accidental side effect, which is what the military says is the case with HAARP. But the question of side effect or deliberate effect really takes us back to this issue of human manipulation. Is it possible? And let's talk about that a little bit more in depth. Talking a little bit more about, you know, sort of what happens within the brain and how ELF signals, extremely low frequency signals, might interact. If you look at an EEG and you look at what the brain is actually doing, you look at those patterns, what we know is that the brain exhibits predominant brain waves during certain times and during certain activities. In your very deepest states of sleep, for instance, it's 1 to 4 hertz or pulses per second of the predominant ELF frequency within the brain. In that sort of middle stage of sleep where you're actively dreaming but you're kind of consciously awake at the same time, this is the theta range, approximately 4 to 7 hertz or pulses per second. 7 to approximately 11 or 12 hertz is the alpha range. This is where you are when you're in that zone or ideal place for learning and doing art and that kind of activity. The beta ranges get into where you're actively listening and participating all the way up to agitated states. And what we know is that any external signal, whether it be flickering light, or whether it be binaural beat created by sound, or whether it be electromagnetic energy being pulsed through the body, or radio frequency energy, all of these things at the right pulse rates can override normal brain function and change the way our brain chemistry then looks, because it starts with the energy interactions that then create the chemical reactions that then create changes in our behaviors. So the idea of accidentally triggering these kinds of events or deliberately doing it, as was discussed by Zbigniew Brzezinski and McDonald, the idea that you could literally do this and affect 70 or 80% of the population within a large area. HAARP can do this as a side effect or a deliberate effect, based on the science and research done by the military in developing these technologies. It's not one of the stated goals of HAARP, but it is an issue that needs to be looked at, and one that Russians and Europeans have begun to raise concerns about, because their research also shows exactly what we're saying is in fact the case. The problem with technology and the directions in which it's going, when you consider things like HAARP, is we're getting away from the bullets and the bombs and ordnance and going to energy-based technologies. Now, energy-based technologies present some unique challenges. Firstly, from the standpoint of really looking at the damage that we create, we affect living systems and electronic systems, but we don't affect the basic infrastructure of countries. You know, we're about to spend $2 trillion in the total expenditures anticipated in Iraq alone. That is a huge amount of expenditure over the years it's going to take to rebuild it and what has already been spent destroying it. So these weapons are being developed to keep the infrastructures in place, but kill or affect the living people within these regions. So the idea of HAARP being turned to these uses in the future as these techniques and technologies are advancing shouldn't be discounted at all. In fact, it should be expected. It is one of the reasons that international bodies are beginning to complain about this technology's potential abuses. So you've got, when you look at HAARP, a very versatile instrument, from earth-penetrating tomography and earth imaging, affecting weather systems, affecting communications, over-the-horizon radar, global shielding. All of those applications, for obvious reasons, people can see strategic advantage. However, again, when you're dealing with literally connecting a machine on the ground to a component of the environment with the expressed intention of manipulating the environment for weapons applications, that concept alone deserves significant international discussion. And because it's being generated in this country, in the United States, it should have significant public discussion about the ramifications, not just within our own territory, but around the world. And that's what's missing from much of the HAARP debate. Now let's go back for a minute to the work of Dr. Ben Eastland. You know, when he originated this concept, it was a long time ago. You know, you're now going back to the late 1980s and the 1980s through the early 1990s. You know, technology's advanced dramatically since then. And Dr. Eastland hasn't just been sitting around either. You know, he's got other projects he's been working on that are quite interesting. And one of those recently, in fact, in October of 2005, he presented a paper at Penn State on weather modification utilizing gravitational waves. Now, what's important about this paper, extremely important about this paper, is that it talks about being able to modify weather using 1,600 times less energy than was anticipated for weather modification applications using HAARP. In other words, 1,600 times less energy than was once thought to be needed. It's now understood by him as a physicist in a major university presentation to be possible. Now, when you think about weather modification, one of the other things that happened with Dr. Eastland is he was invited by the European Space Agency to do a paper on weather modification utilizing the HAARP systems. That was completed in 1999 and presented for peer review at a major space expo in Europe. Coming off of that paper, FEMA and NASA contracted with Dr. Eastland to prepare a paper utilizing space-based technologies, satellite-based technologies for weather modification applications. And one of the things that he saw and that he mentions in both these papers is, for instance, being able to affect tornadoes. And the idea of tornadoes, you know, you have a warm front coming into contact with a cold front, and when they come together, you get a shearing force that causes that twisting action where you get the tornado formation. So the idea of Eastland was if you could heat the cold front sufficiently that when these two fronts connected, you didn't get that energy differential to create that tornado formation, you could essentially knock out tornadoes. The problem is, of course, if you miss and you heat the already heated area so that there's even a greater differential when it encounters the cold front, you have more energy available to create even a more destructive tornado. The fact of the matter is, other governments around the world have taken this very seriously, including our own, and has invested a significant amount of money to look at how to, in fact, affect these things. Remember a few years ago, back during the Clinton administration, actually, there was a tornado that whipped through Oklahoma City, and Clinton showed up, and there was a press report that talked about him saying, don't worry, eventually we're going to figure out how to knock out the energy of those tornadoes, and these won't ever hurt civilized cities again. Well, You know, that was the same city where Ben Eastland at the University of Oklahoma did his computer modeling to figure out how to knock out the energy in those tornadoes a few months before. So what Clinton was actually saying was based on the scientific evidence that had been produced in that very same city just months before. The idea of weather modification continues to be of major interest, again, as we advance this revolution in military affairs, which is this concept of warfare emerging here in the beginning of the 21st century and at the end of the last century. Now, that concept essentially came from a paper written in 1989 by the U.S. Army War College, and it was a paper that was called The Revolution of Military Affairs. And what it said is that the technology was changing so dramatically, they equated it with the change that happened when gunpowder was introduced to Europe in the Middle Ages, or when atomic weapons were introduced in the middle of the last century. That's the kind of revolution taking place today, using energy as the base of the science. Not bullets and bombs, but speed of light technologies, from high-powered lasers to particle beams to HAARP systems. These are the systems of the 21st century, and here's what we have to consider. When you're using energy discharges, like for instance in an anti-ballistic missile arrangement where you've got incoming missiles, you know, here in Alaska, we've become the place where they've built the new missile defense system. So they've installed in underground silos interceptors, you know, literally bullets to hit other bullets flying at us at about 30,000 miles an hour in reentry speeds. They're going to try and pick those off, and in most of the tests so far conducted, they failed. The reality is they won't use conventional warheads to knock out these craft. They're going to use space-based laser systems that are being developed, other energy-based systems. And the reason we know this is because you have the ability to, number one, target with precision. These weapons, when they fire a laser or a particle beam, they travel at the speed of light, 186,300 miles per second. That can literally go around the planet seven times with time left over in less than a second. So being able to target, say, an intercontinental ballistic missile, you'd literally be able to knock it out of the sky before it ever left the launch pad with this type of technology. That's where missile defense is going in the 21st century. The interceptors are the party line for the public. The reality is these other systems are advancing. The Department of Energy has owned patents since the late 1980s that are cited in the book Earth Rising, the Revolution, which I wrote with James Roderick a number of years ago. The fact is they've had the technology, they're advancing the technology. HAARP is a part of this advancement, this revolution in military affairs. The other thing that's happening and where the HAARP issue starts to cross over is the idea of affecting our physical bodies, affecting our health or our mental states. That is an area of technology that has raised huge, huge controversies around the world today, and is continuing to be raised today because of the implications in 21st century warfare. Now, take the concept of speed of light weapons and overlay that concept on this idea that George W. Bush has introduced as President of the United States, called preemptive warfare. This is the concept of figuring out who your enemies are before they know they're your enemies and wiping them out. You know, it works good when you're the top dog, when you own all the technologies that make preemptive warfare effective. But in the advent of speed of light weapons, weapons that discharge instantly where there is no time to react, is preemptive warfare a concept we want to introduce to the world scene today? China, the largest industrial power emerging on the planet, 13% growth per year consistently, 11 to 13% growth per year, building the largest industrial base, dwarfing the industrial revolution of the West of the last century. They're going to be capable of developing these very same technologies. They say, don't worry about the Chinese. They only spend $40 to $44 billion a year on defense. A fraction of what we spend in the United States. In fact, 10% approximately of what we spend in the United States. But if you look at what you buy in China for $44 billion, it's significantly more than we get for all the money we spend on defense within this country. That is a major, major issue. Taking from the brains of a billion citizens in a centralized government like China's and isolating those technologists, those future scientists, those engineers that can develop this type of technology is in fact a major area of Chinese advancement, according to things being released by our Central Intelligence Agency today. Articles that have appeared in Russian military journals and other journals indicate that they are moving along the same path that we are with as much speed as we are. The problem is, again, the ideologies behind the technologies, whether it's the Chinese government, the Chinese military, or whether it's the United States government. Whatever the value systems that drive our technology, they should come from the people and spring forward. That's the nature of democratic republics. That's the nature of democracies. That's what's missing in the evolution of military technologies around the world today, including the United States. One of the other applications of the HAARP technology is the idea of energy transfer from one place on the planet to another. And this is really one of the more interesting ones. It's one of the first tests, in fact, the first test of a small array was to see if you could focus the radio frequency energy in a way where you could take electrical energy, convert it to radio frequency energy, then send it back up into, say, a satellite or a low orbiting space platform, and turn that radio frequency energy back into electrical energy where it can be utilized as a power source. Now, why this is important as a power source, if you think about it, low orbiting space platforms, if you could put these low orbiting space platforms around the planet to utilize energy-based technologies like space-based lasers, you could get closer to your targets, but you have to have a fuel source. You can't just keep sending shuttles up there with energy. You have to be able to get the energy to those low orbiting space platforms. And what they figured they could do with HAARP and systems like HAARP is keep energized space platforms for up to 10,000 hour missions. So literally, indefinitely, keeping objects afloat by continually feeding them the necessary energy they need to recharge and maintain their power levels. The other place where they looked at low-orbiting space platforms is using the ionosphere itself, literally tapping the energy as these space platforms whip through the ionosphere using tethers, long conductors dragging from below, actually picking up power along the way. And you remember the shuttle experiment a number of years ago where they did this with a tether hanging from the shuttle, and such a huge amount of power built up that it almost blew the shuttle out of the sky. The reality is these are all ways of looking at energy-based warfare systems, something that we haven't had in the past. In the 1980s, during the first of Star Wars, these were discounted because you couldn't stabilize satellites to, for instance, fire a laser. And if you get just a little bit of wobble from a distance, you know, the further you go, the further out that wobble becomes. If you're a carpenter, you know that if you start on one side of a house and you're a 1/16 of an inch out, by the time you're on the other side of the house, you're an inch out. Well, imagine from space being a 1/16 of an inch out where you would be. You'd be miles off your target. So space platforms stabilizing became an issue for the 90s, which they actually figured out how to do it, making that type of technology applicable in this century. When you look at the combinations, it's pretty remarkable. One of the other places they looked at an experiment, you remember the shuttle experiment where they unraveled a big mylar reflector, and this was supposed to be going to collect solar energy and reflect it so they could use this energy. Well, it just so happens within the patent, solar reflectors were also needed in the case of HAARP because of the, again, sending energy up, being able to concentrate it to a relatively small area and then bounce that energy through these reflectors to other parts of the planet where that energy could then be converted back to electrical energy. Now, why would that be important? Anytime you have a war, you need power sources. If you could literally do it wirelessly and get your energy without moving diesel fuel and all the stuff that you have to move logistically, that becomes pretty advantageous. So wireless transfer of energy became one of these very concepts. Interestingly enough, during the Hickel administration, when he was governor of Alaska, Glenn Olds, one of his, I believe he was a commissioner of commerce at the time, actually had this concept of wireless transfer of energy for remote places in Alaska. So these concepts aren't new, they're just being revisited in light of new technology. HAARP happens to present a bit of that technology as well. Over the years, HAARP has created, you know, quite a lot of controversy. In fact, you know, when you look on, if you do a search under HAARP, H-A-A-R-P on the internet, you'll find thousands and thousands of sources and documents and materials, some of it pretty outrageous, quite frankly, and some of it right on target. Like any issue, HAARP is no exception. It draws a lot of controversy, draws a lot of misinformation to the debate as well. You know, this video was prepared to give a summation of the technology, but I recommend highly that people take a look. Get the book from your local library, Angels Don't Play This Harp. There's over 350 sources cited in that book that validate all of the things that we've covered today. Take a look. When you're looking at these kinds of issues, big issues that can literally change the face of the planet, look deeper. Make sure that the facts are there. Make sure the information is there. But then get that information to those that can make a difference, whether it's your local political leadership coming out of your own states and your own countries. The fact of the matter is these technologies have to be engaged in the true light of day. We can't allow militaries to advance technologies that have these kinds of implications for the planet, for our health, for our environment. You know, if we're really to be stewards of this planet, it requires real action. Each of us can do something within our spheres of influence to make a difference, whether it's this issue or any of the other issues we cover in this series. The fact of the matter is, people make the difference, people make things change, and we need to engage the processes and do exactly that. And let's let our technology serve us in the 21st century as man intends it to do, and not create just another situation that we have to clean up in the next century. Thanks for spending the time with me today. Check out one of our other videos. We've got the mind control video, technologies in the 21st century, and a new video being produced on earth changes. Thanks for being with me.